Thank you for coming. I'm really delighted to see so many people here, considering what's happening outside. So that's absolutely fantastic. Is this microphone working?
Somewhere in the 1860s. Thank you.
Here we go. And he grew up, though, in the town of Texarkana. And he learned about music in terms of singing, in terms of playing the guitar, the violin, and the piano. He left his home in his teen years and began working as a traveling musician, playing in bars and dance halls where new musical forms were featured that formed the basis of ragtime. And when we think about ragtime as a form, there's often a syncopated melody that's in the right hand, and then there's a rhythmic bass part that's in the left hand, which consists of chords on the off beats and strong notes on the strong beats, which basically form a rhythmic structure for the song. He was very motivated to promote ragtime as what we say in the popular music world as a legit form of music. Normally, you know, jazz people talk about legit music as being classical and their own form as being not illegit, but at the same time not given the same amount of due in society's perception of things. So, you know, in other words, pop music is something that people do when they're not serious. It's entertainment music. But Joplin wanted to take this form and make it into a classically accepted form. Music for the ballet, music for opera, and so forth. And indeed, he had ambitions for it to be an operatic form, which culminated in the composition of an opera, which was called Treemonisha, towards the end of his life. But there was a lot of challenges that he faced along the way. The fleeting popularity of music, for example, is something that a lot of contemporary artists have encountered. So when we go to a classical concert, sometimes we hear music by Bach or Handel, which is over 300 years old. In the pop music world, something that you hear on the radio today probably won't be heard at all in 10 years unless it really, really does stand out. Think about the history of popular music. We consider the classic hits to be 30, 40, 50 years old. But when you compare that to the length of memory of classical music, which is in the hundreds of years, some cases the many hundreds of years, the popular form is just a little bit more fleeting. And I don't think that that's a substantive observation in the sense that popular music doesn't have substance. Of course it does, but I think part of it is our attention span is different in many respects. So in the same way that a popular style of clothing to wear or popular figures of speech and lingo or popular television shows or something along those lines, they have a run of popularity and then, you know, people just move on to something else. And Joplin experienced that indeed with ragtime, as ragtime was giving way to other forms of music. He was hoping to diversify the perception of ragtime so that, you know, it would have a longevity that it appeared not to be having. So this was a great conflict for him and a great challenge for him. His compositions, always to me, they have a melancholy character to them, even the most seemingly joyful ones. And I think that that speaks a little bit to the complexity of his personality. The rags that I've chosen today, there's a bit of variety there. The magnetic rag was one of my earliest favorite pieces when I was a boy. But for Christmas one year, my father got me a recording of Scott Joplin rags being played very beautifully on the piano, and I used to go to bed listening again and again to the magnetic rag, which was a song I just absolutely loved. It's very, very pretty. And amiable, there's that word again. I mean, it just brings you into it. The Entertainer was made very famous in the 1973 film The Sting, if anybody saw that, with Robert Redford and Paul Newman, right. And I don't know if you can call it the theme song to The Sting, but it was certainly a very popular piece in The Sting. And all of the pianist kids, just like me at that time, were all in a great hurry to learn it to impress our schoolmates. And so I remember being asked many times if I could play The Entertainer. It was a little bit beyond me at the time, so I kind of invented my own way of playing it, which I've tried to unlearn over the years. The Palm Leaf Rag is a really beautiful, and again, a slightly melancholy expression. It reminds me of a warm summer's day. Elite syncopations, speaking of the ballet, this actually was used to choreograph a new ballet that Kenneth McMillan, the choreographer for the Royal Ballet, produced in 1974 in London. And it is often in the repertoire of ballet companies now, and so that Joplin's music, particularly the song, inspired that. And then there are several others. The Peacherine Rag, the Ragtime Dance, very, very famous, and Eugenia, another lovely rag. And then lastly, the Maple Leaf Rag, which apparently has nothing to do with Canada. And that surprised me when I learned that. Joplin never visited Canada. I'm sure he never even thought about Canada, but at the same time, he must have enjoyed the maple tree. That's one of his most famous rags. So quite a bit of variety, actually, in the form. One thing, too, every single rag seems to have, at the tempo marking, not fast, or not to be played fast, or sometimes an admonition. Ragtime is never to be played fast. Occasionally, they say a la Marcia, which is like a march, but still not fast. He was really trying to break that perception that ragtime was something that was a kind of frantic music. It's more of a music that draws you in and that is reflective. And so that's the music of Scott Joplin. So I arranged these for the organ some years ago, a very, very different kind of organ to this one. It was actually at St. Paul's Bloor Street, which is a very romantic sounding instrument in a very reverberant space in Toronto there. Whereas this kind of Franco-Germanic classically voiced instrument is a bit like playing it under a microscope, whereas the other organ was more luxuriant. So I've had to adapt the pieces a little bit more to be played on this organ, but I think it went pretty well. You can have that discussion with yourself. What else was I going to say? Oh yeah, the soup. I was asked just to say sopa de lima, which is our soup today, has nothing to do with lima beans. There are no beans in it. Nor does it have anything to do with the capital city of Peru. Lima in this case refers to limes. So there are limes in it. It's a beautiful soup. As always, I like to chat a bit about the soup before it's made and what we're going to choose, and we always hope that they're popular with you. You know you're always welcome at the soups, and you know where to find them. So on the back of your program, you'll see the lineup that we have for March. I was hoping to have the Canadian Horn Quartet here next Tuesday, but they have had to cancel, so you'll be stuck with me again. But then after that, we'll be bringing in some other artists for the rest of the month. So I commend all of those to you, and thank you as always for your support of Music as Sanctuary. Thank you very much. I hope you enjoy the concert.
Thank you.